Atherosclerosis is a condition of coronary heart disease that involves progressive narrowing of the arterial vessels that interferes with blood flow. The development of plaque and hardening of the vessel walls are common to this condition. In this video, we will explain the process of how plaque develops in the blood vessels and relate that to understanding the risk factors for atherosclerosis. Plaque in the blood vessels develops over a period of time due to a complex process that we do not completely understand yet. However, we believe it begins with damage that occurs to the blood vessel walls, which triggers an inflammatory immune response. The LDL cholesterol that is circulating through the blood enter the damaged area and are engulfed by these immune factors within the walls of the blood vessel, creating foam cells. Oxidation of LDL from smoking and other free radicals worsen this problem. The fatty streaks thicken to form plaque that narrows the opening of the blood vessel. This can restrict blood from carrying oxygen and nutrients to cells, especially within the heart, lungs, and brain. So there are three main steps we just discussed in plaque development: damage to the blood vessels, inflammatory response, and LDL cholesterol, especially oxidized LDL. Understanding these parts of the process can help make important connections with risk factors. Let's begin with discussing the factors that lead to damaged blood vessels. The first risk factor is shear stress from high blood pressure. When a person's blood pressure remains high over time, that pressure that builds up in the vessel can tear the walls. In addition to high blood pressure, high blood glucose levels also cause damage. Poor management of blood sugars and diabetes is a leading risk factor for heart disease. Smoking is another highly dangerous problem for the coronary vessels. Toxins from smoke damage blood vessels, constrict blood flow, and increase oxidative stress that leads to oxidized LDL. These three are all risk factors for heart disease. Yet another risk factor that damages blood vessels is high levels of homocysteine. Vitamins B6, B12, and folate are coenzymes necessary to break down homocysteine so that it won't damage blood vessels. Therefore, low dietary intakes of vitamins B6, B12, and folate can lead to high homocysteine, which damages blood vessels, stimulating that immune response. So let's talk about this inflammatory response. Since atherosclerosis involves an inflammatory response, circulating immune factors can contribute to fatty streaks and arterial plaque development. Hyperinflammatory response from infections in the body can increase the risk of plaque developing in the blood vessels. This is why dentists will often talk to you about heart disease. Inflammation from periodontal disease increases risk of arterial plaque and atherosclerosis. Once those immune factors are flowing through the blood, they can engulf LDL cholesterol, especially at the damaged areas in blood vessels. Both LDL and VLDL cholesterol are taken up and retained in the arterial wall. Oxidized LDL may do this more easily and lead to even more inflammatory response. Therefore, the amount of LDL in your bloodstream has a direct impact on plaque. The higher the levels of LDL circulating in your bloodstream, the higher the risk of atherosclerosis. Once plaque begins to develop, continuing to have high LDL will speed up the progression of advanced atherosclerosis and double the risk of coronary heart disease. Now, HDL, which we know as the good cholesterol, prevents oxidation of LDL and removes cholesterol from the vessels. Therefore, low amounts of HDL is associated with a higher risk of atherosclerosis. Research in this area of cholesterol is ongoing, but some of the more recent research suggests the biggest risk lies in the amount of LDL in the blood. While HDL does have an impact, it may not have as much of an effect on plaque development as LDL does. Of course, there are always risk factors we can't do anything about. Increasing age and family history are risk factors we cannot control, but it can help us understand the need for vigilance and prevention when we understand both modifiable and non-modifiable risk factors.